When I look out my window, many sights to see. And when I look in my window, so many different people to be. It's strange, so strange. It's very strange to me. You got to pick up every stitch. You got to pick up every stitch. You got to pick up every stitch. Oh no.
Spider-Man and the Secret Balls. Prepare for Prattle.
Shock-Phobia Fest.
Welcome to Prattle World. I am your host, the ever-amazing, ever-spectacular Spider Dan. And in this podcast, I spotlight entertainment's best-kept secrets that a mainstream audience may find boring. And welcome to Shock-Phobia Fest, a month-long celebration of All Hallows Eve's most frightening films and comic spooks. And I am very excited to have two of my favourite guests and best friends here to talk about some witches. You could say I'm as light as a feather and as stiff as a board, if you catch my meaning. So we are here to list our top five witch films, witch movies, and I'm joined by the skeptic Scott.
Hello.
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 Hello. Hello. Welcome. And Lucy Jane Devane is here again. We talked Twilight last time. We're delving back into the spooky feminism side of things of the podcast world. It's going to be an interesting discussion. So welcome back, guys.
Thank you.
This podcast germinated about a year or so ago when I found myself the victim of, obviously, a witch's curse, clearly. Mm-hmm. I locked myself out of my flat. And it couldn't have been possibly have been my fault. It couldn't have been me. It must have been a witch's curse. And I found myself with nowhere to go, nowhere to stay. And luckily, Lucy and Scott put me up for almost the entire weekend and put up with me for the entire weekend as well. So they were very kind to do that. And during that time, Scott was working, but me and Lucy had some time together. And she's like, what do you want to watch? And I was like, what would Lucy like? She's very artistic. She's into, you know, that's part of her uni course and everything. And I chose Suspiria, of all things, Dario Argento, classic, colourful, witchy film. And it was definitely an experience. And we got chatting about witches. And then we followed it up with our double bill with The Witch. But yeah, I didn't know this about Lucy, that you are completely fascinated with witches and witch culture. But it was very interesting, and that germinated this idea. So why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
I don't really know where it started. I remember watching Bewitched, that little cartoon, like many years ago when I was kind of getting ready for school, and I always thought that was kind of cool. And then I did read the Worst Witch books, which I think J.K. Rowling kind of took some stuff from those books.
Yeah, maybe a little bit.
I really enjoyed those. And then also, so I've kind of lived in a few different places growing up, from Gloucestershire originally, and then my mum sort of moved to like different shires. So I've lived in quite a few different shires, Gloucestershire and also Shropshire. But I think, like I was saying, I think there's like a sort of I don't know if it was kind of like a 90s sort of new age thing, but I felt like there was a lot of like crystal shops and like kind of hippie stuff and like the candles and the incense and the kind of tarot cards and all that sort of stuff. And I really kind of bought into all of that. So I had like lots of different stars in my room and kind of incense and candles and things, and really kind of got into that. But then I think also growing up at school, I kind of moved to a new school where I didn't know anybody, new town, new city, didn't know anybody. And I think that's kind of where I started to feel that kind of, you know, when you have like a someone who moves to a new school and they want that acceptance, and there's this kind of cliques and things like that. And I think that's maybe where some of my...
The outsider.
Yeah, I think kind of the craft and, you know, that those kind of being the outsider and kind of wanting to fit in. And I, particularly, I think girls are pretty horrible to each other.
Yeah, there's a bit of that.
Too, but yeah. I think I kind of... That kind of spoke to me a little bit, I suppose, with some of those kind of like... Yeah, kind of teen sort of fitting in, finding your people, finding your place and all that sort of stuff. So
found family.
Yeah. Mm. So I think that's kind of where it might have stemmed from. Mm. And then I got into it so much that my mum bought me a broomstick one year. I must have been into it like quite heavily for her to do that, because she knew I'd appreciate it. But it's just like the ones they use in Practical Magic when they sweep out the air. So I think she did actually use it for cleaning later on. But it was very lovely.
I think she used it for witchcraft. I think she harnessed the powers of Satan to clean your house.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe. But yeah, so that was my... And also, you know, have dabbled in the whole crystal world with, you know, I'm interested in that, and like psychic mediums and all that sort of jazz.
Tarot cards.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. The whole kit and caboodle.
The whole lot. Sign me up for it all. I'm into it. Not like Scott, who obviously isn't.
Yeah, a bit more sceptical of that sort of thing. Yeah.
Sure.
Not into the crystal.
That's why you make such a good couple.
No.
So you balance each other out.
Yang,
exactly.
Yeah.
Scott, obviously this was an idea that me and Lucy germinated, but what are your feelings on kind of witches, witchcraft, witch culture and films and stuff?
Well, like you say, I've always been a bit of a skeptic. So I didn't really believe in any of that growing up. And whenever someone mentioned it, like any kids in the playground or anything, I just thought, oh, it's a load of rubbish. But I do remember I think the first time I heard of anything sort of witch-like or mystical. I remember a kid saying he was going to play with a Ouija board. So I think this was when I was about 10. And I misheard him. I thought he said a Luigi board.
Okay.
And I thought, oh, is that like some sort of Super Mario board game? That sounds delightful. But obviously, I later found out what it was. I think I used a Ouija board once, but I sort of just thought, oh, you know, it's whoever's moving it is subconsciously doing it or whatever. But yeah, and then obviously
super skeptic.
And especially with like fairy tales and a lot of Disney films, obviously have witches as the evil baddie. I've not enjoyed all of the films that we're going to be talking about.
Okay.
Got issues with some of them.
Sure.
But yeah,
this will be interesting.
Some of them I was quite surprised by. So,
Okay. That's interesting. Yeah. Mm. I think there was a lot. I think there was definitely something going around. I think when we were growing up, that type of supernatural, like, oh, if we put these twigs in this formation, it'll, you know, a witch will come and stuff. There was a lot of that in my kind of primary school. And again, the Ouija board was actually a board game that people put all that kind of superstition on top of. And then it became like legend, because it's you can still buy it now. You can still buy like the original Ouija board from, I don't know, Parker Games or whoever made it. So yeah, there was definitely a lot of that. So I can definitely buy in to this kind of reemergence of stuff. I've quite enjoyed kind of looking into the kind of witch culture and where that comes from, and the kind of agendas around them. Like, for me, like the films I looked at are from lots of different cultures, like all over the world, there is a witch or a bruja or whatever you want to call, whatever the culture calls them. But there is like a lone woman, an older woman, an unmarried woman, you know, living on the outskirts of society. Why is she not fitting in with everyone? Why is she the outsider? Why is she not married? Why is she, you know, and there are all these stories and superstitions and kind of like, you know, there's a lot of kind of those witch hunts we talk about, like in society, you know, whatever if someone's doing something on the fringes of society, you know, they're like, oh, they're a witch. You know, back in the days, it was like, that woman's having an independent thought. Kill her, murder her, she's a witch. Drown her, you know, and nowadays it's kind of, there's other groups that unfortunately are kind of people go after as, you know, maybe not pertaining to family values or something like that. So I found it quite interesting that it's kind of like a patriarchal thing almost. They're trying to strip women of their power and the having these conversations and these meetings and stuff. And they're like, oh, well, this is like the word trivia come, you know, which was about Italian women meeting where the roads met, which is trivia, which is three roads, crossroads. They would talk, and then, but that word developed into trivial because it's men stripping them of power because they don't want them to be doing or having any sort of say or things like that. So there's some really kind of interesting things historically and kind of, you know, that feminine power that we don't want that to get out of control. Oh no, God forbid. The women take over, you know, and yeah, so I've quite enjoyed that historical and social aspect of these films. But obviously there's, you know, there's good witches and bad witches and there's a lot of variation. So I've really enjoyed kind of digging into that. So I like the deep dives into these kind of things.
Yeah.
But I think that's enough on witches in general. Mm-hmm. But this is the final podcast of Shock-Phobia Fest. So no pressure, guys, no pressure. Okay. But we've got to go out with a bang. Unfortunately, I brought all this equipment around today and none of it's working. So this recording is through the iPod microphone, the iPad microphone. So if it's not as good quality as usual, you know why. It's unfortunate. But one cable out of all of the things I brought is not working and it's fucked it. I believe the witches didn't want us to record this.
We're cursed. I'm a bit under the weather as well. So.
There you go. Oh, hex. Yeah. It's a hex.
Something's going on.
The cats left the room as well. So yeah.
All signs are pointing.
They're like, I'm staying out of this shit. I'm not getting involved in all this. You know, and Scott is obviously going to be very critical of the witches right now. So we're going to find out. So it's a top five. So we have to list our top five witch movies. I've gone for a wide range of stuff. And I am interested to find out what your first witch movie is on your top five.
Well, should we go with The Vivitch?
That sounds good.
Yes.
Sort of the reason why we're here today, anyway. Yeah.
So we actually watched it with you.
Yes, yeah,
yourself.
We did. Yeah, I'd never seen it before either.
First time you all saw it. Very creepy. I don't know.
Very Vivitchy. It's very atmospheric.
Atmospheric, kind of,
that's the word you're looking for.
That's the word. I think it's Anya Taylor-Joy's sort of breakthrough role. Mm. And she's phenomenal in it. She's very good. I think the look of it, it seems to be, I think a lot of the lighting was done naturally as well. And it's just very grim. As soon as they move to this area where they're going to be, you know, spending the rest of their life, so they think where they're setting up home, you get a very creepy vibe straight off and something's not quite right. And that whole feeling just goes throughout the whole film, I think.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a, well, I'm not great with horror films. I spent a lot of it watching it.
You not good with horror films? What?
through my hands, because just, yeah, and as Dan well knows, a few sort of jumpy scares or a little bit of creepy sound.
Like, we watched a trailer earlier, Lucy, and you jumped out of your skin. Not even a full film.
I know. I'm really bad with it. I think maybe that's also why, like, I'm really interested in this sort of supernatural stuff because it actually terrifies me. And I feel like it's that kind of, it's the stuff you know, you're not seeing. It's very sort of weird goings on, unexplained things. And I think, yeah, it's that, it's very kind of, you know, they're out in the woods and it, you know, it, you don't see a lot for like for the most part of the film until really the kind of like, I suppose, like three quarters of the way in.
Hmm.
But yeah, there's this bit where it's like really innocent, where she's kind of playing Boo with this little baby. Hmm. And, you know, she's like covering her eyes and just sort of doing peekaboo and stuff. And then all of a sudden the baby just vanishes, just nothing, like no trace or anything. And then things start to kind of go a bit wrong and, you know, all the rest of it. But yeah, it's kind of, I mean, I did spend a lot of like it watching it through my hands. But I also do think the sound design has a lot yes. to do with that. When I think about, like, it was quite a quiet film, because there are lots of scenes that there's just very quiet and actually there's not a lot happening. Like, it's, you know, someone's chopping wood or they're just kind of washing clothes and it's very kind of mundane family stuff. But then all of a sudden it just ramps up with the sound design and it's so powerful and so eerie. And that's enough for me to be like, oh my God, what the
very, fuck? Very unnerving.
Yeah. But we did have a bit of a giggle because obviously there's some kind of some weird bits in it, but there's,
oh yeah,
that, you know, the goat, Black Philip, he's obviously yeah. a little mischievous. The twins, I'm never really sure if the twins are kind of in naughty or they're good or yeah. what they're doing, but they're kind of being, you know, being a bit weird and messing around with this goat. But yeah, it gets quite sinister. And then I think it's kind of, you start to see a little bit more. Although, I mean, I say you start, I don't actually know.
You don't, because you're covering your eyes the entire time.
I was going, what was it?
Oh, God.
Is it the way? But I think, yeah, there's not a lot of colour in the film, but there is that one scene where Caleb wanders into the forest or he hears something or sees something, and then there's like a little hut, and then this beautiful, well-breasted lady comes out of some sort of shack.
Yeah.
But she's got this, like, almost like Red Riding Hood look about her. Yeah. She's got this really vivid, and I think that's the only colour in the whole film is that bright red of her cape. But it, you know, she looks too good to be true. It's this, you know, she's got that kind of look about her. But then as she gets a bit close to Caleb, she kind of, I don't know, what does she do? Eat his face?
I think she took, if I remember rightly, I think it's like The Shining when like Jack Nicholson goes and sees the woman in the tub. She's beautiful and naked. But then when he gets close to her, and then she's just this old hag with droopy breasts and stuff.
Yeah.
I think it was a similar situation with that. I think the camera turns or shifts or something.
Yeah, because they do that a couple of times. There's like the bit where the mother thinks her son, her baby's back, and she starts feeding the baby, and it turns out that it's actually a crow that's pecking at her. And
God, yeah, I remember that.
that was very disturbing.
Yeah.
But yeah, you mentioned The Shining. I only sort of picked up on this when we watched it again recently for the second time, and it's very similar to The Shining. Obviously, it's the story is a family going to a place, and they're on their own. There's something mystical going on, and it's turning all of them crazy, and eventually turns them all against each other. Yeah. And there's a creepy couple of twins in there as well.
Yes.
I do really enjoy their Yorkshire accents.
Yeah.
I really enjoy that. And I don't know why, but I feel like there's a kind of, I don't know. I just really quite like that. But also obviously it's very, you know, this like New England,
yes,
you know, very God-fearing. I don't really understand why he wants to move away in the first, like,
from what I understand, I think they've been kicked out because they're like religious extremists.
Yeah, right. So that they were too religious.
They were too Puritan for Puritans. Right. So Puritanism is like you can only do things that worship God. Like at any point, if it's not to worship God, you're evil. So these guys must have been like, they're
extra.
Like, you can't even take a shit unless it services God in some way. Like, that's how, and again, that kind of comes into that, you know, the witch thing and the kind of the history of witches and that religious oppression and, you know, cracking down on women and giving them scarlet letters and kicking them out of. But I completely agree with you. I think it's fantastic. I think it's Robert Eggers, I think, is the director.
It's his first film.
Yeah, and it's a corker.
Yeah.
It's a bloody corker for everyone involved. And you've got, is it Finchy from...
Finchy. I love Finchy. He is absolutely... I mean, his voice is very distinctive.
Yes.
But for this, it's just perfect. Mm. He just sounds so good. Mm.
I always recognise his voice, no matter what he's in. Yeah. I think I played like Assassin's Creed Black Flag. I think he's in there.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, there's Finchy. Yeah. Like, you can recognise it anywhere. But I have to agree, it's very atmospheric. Again, it gives you that unnerving feeling all the way through. You're never comfortable.
No.
And again, it doesn't show a lot. It, like you said, it is quite mundane, like not boring.
No, it's almost like that kind of, it's that everyday kind of monotony.
Yes.
The fact that they've obviously not got a lot to eat. They're worried about hunting and they have got this kind of fear of the forest. So they don't want to kind of, you know, go into the forest. And they've got a lot of like, I feel like also it's quite ethereal. There's a lot of kind of, you know, animal, they're reliant on animals very much. Like they've got the dog, the horse, obviously the goats. But when things start kind of going a bit wrong, the horse, they I think the horse like bucks off Thomason and she kind of flies on the ground for a bit and then, or the dog gets kind of mauled by something and he's all kind of disemboweled and stuff. So then the kind of hunting dog's gone. And there's like this hare that keeps appearing in the forest. And I feel like that's kind of these symbols of animals and kind of earthly creatures and things. But it sort of takes a bit of a turn and things start, you know.
Yeah, very, very natural. Again, like it does look like it could have been, like Scott was saying, like the natural light. It does feel like, you know, a grey day in Manchester, but you're in the woods somewhere or something. So there is that. I think that adds to the realism. So when the fantastic stuff does come along, it's kind of still grounded in a way.
Yeah.
Like it's not like, oh, this is completely out of the blue and weird. It's like kind of, it fits. It's like the natural world becomes so natural it's unnatural.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Or supernatural.
And I think as well, like thinking about it, I suppose like the thing about the food, because I think in one scene they're kind of, things have started to happen and they're a bit afraid and Finchy says, you know, we're gonna pray tonight and we're gonna fast tomorrow. And food is a real scarcity for them, and like through it they're kind of crop, you know, they're kind of harvesting corn or whatever, and then they go off to try and hunt and they can't find anything and the mum's freaking out and they've got all these kids to feed and all the rest of it. But then I think Thomason goes to get an egg from the hen from the hen pen or whatever it is, and sort of it drops on the floor and then it breaks open, and we were trying to work out, so obviously she couldn't, that would have been something that they could have used, but then it was kind of had a chick in it, or like it was kind of all bloody.
It looked like
really
a chick part.
What it was. Yeah. So that kind of was like, okay, well, that's gone. That you can't eat that. And then she's milking the goats, and it should be milk, and then there's blood. And then what else? Oh, and then obviously the final scene.
Oh, yeah. Spoilers.
Should I? Yeah. I don't know. I'm just like, if it's all.
If you haven't seen the Witch, go and see the Witch.
But the last bit. And there's like a great one, or the great line about, you know, do you want to live deliciously and do you want to, is it taste butter or something?
Mm. Yeah, something along
those lines. So I feel like it's very kind of like food based, like live, you know, you kind of need that survival, that food. So I kind of felt like there was.
I think butter was banned by the church.
Really? That makes sense.
So I think that's why he was trying to tempt her with butter.
It's like, oh, here you go, butter.
I did not know that. Mm.
And if they're fasting as well and the, you know, food's scarce, that's a big luxury. So. Mm.
And I don't know if they do this on purpose, but I could not help but notice how bad the state of their corn looked as the film went on. And I said to you, I was like, that corn scene, much better days. But I was thinking about it tonight as we were eating our corn on the cob.
That was good corn. That was good corn.
It was good corn. You know, and it's like lovely and yellow and buttery, but oh, not in this film. It's dried as anything.
I think I've read some theories that people think, oh, it's not actually witches, that they're just hallucinating because of... The food they've had. I think there's some
shortage of food. Or...
Yeah, so either they're deprived of food and they're hallucinating, or some of the food they're eating. I think there is something that can grow on corn that can make you hallucinate.
Mold or something.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. But then obviously what happens at the end of the film?
Skeptic Scott.
It's in the food, not the supernatural.
But yeah, what happens at the end of the film, you know, it hints at that, no, there is something supernatural and they are witches.
And I feel like they're eating children. even though it's not.
Am I right? It's been a while. I think I've not seen it since we watched it. Does the brother crack on to Anna Taylor-Joy as well? Like,
so early on, he's sort of, you know, looking at her bosom.
Yes.
So obviously there's no one else around.
Yeah, I guess.
They're the only
teenage
family.
Boy, yeah.
He's starting to feel these feelings, and she's the only sort of girl around his age. So
So then when the witch comes along, he's like, oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, baby.
But also going back to the food thing again. Mm. So they get a bit spooked in the forest, and Thomason kind of falls off the horse, hits her head, and then Caleb kind of runs off, and this is when he sees Red Riding Hood.
Yeah.
We'll call her that for now. Then we don't actually see what happens, but then she says she's going to go and bed the goats down, which I think means put them to bed.
I certainly hope so in that context. I hope her and Black Philip are having one special night together.
She goes to put the goats down to bed, and then Caleb's there naked, all sort of like... It just like reappears, and he's thin, and he's like, you know, hallucinating. He's like on death's door, basically. And then he's all kind of like possessed and not very well. And then he has like something in it. His mouth's like kind of shut. And then Finchy, his dad, like cuts his mouth open, and this like apple comes out of his mouth. He kind of like sicks at this apple, which I don't know. It's like, oh, and they go on about apples as well. Apples is like, I don't know why.
I guess maybe that's like, I guess it's a symbol of like the Garden of Eden and maybe purity or perfection, or, you know, Snow White has the apple, poison apple. So that's tied into the kind of folk tale stuff. So yeah, maybe the apple is like a sign of something. I'm not
indulgence
quite sure.
Indulgence or something, or kind of,
beauty, a perfect life or something.
Yeah. It's good. Yeah.
Might be something there. That's, excellent. No, excellent choice. I think a lot of people agree with you. We got some comments later. I think they've mentioned the Vivage.
Excellent.
So, yeah, I'm going to go with my choice now. So I wanted to go with one. You've gone with one that's very supernatural and or not, according to Skeptic Scott. Whoever you want to believe, I'm not here to argue either way. But I wanted to kind of, there's parts of the world that are still kind of quite superstitious and quite, you know, they kind of believe witches still exist. And it's kind of, it's a real thing. It's a, you know, it's a prejudice. There's some superstition there, maybe even racism or whatever you want to call it. But there's definitely cultures and societies in the world that still fully believe this is a thing and will go to extreme lengths to protect themselves from these so-called witches, whoever they determine to be a witch. So I picked a film called I Am Not a Witch from 2017. It is by a Welsh Gambian director called Rungano Nioni. So basically it's set in Zambia, and there's a young girl who comes to this village. They don't know where she's from. She appears suddenly out of the blue. And the village are terrified because they think she doesn't speak, she doesn't say anything. She's accused of being a witch because the water's turned bad, apparently. They were like, she drank from the water and it's evil now. It's going to kill us. They get all these police in, they get some politicians in, all this sort of stuff. And she won't deny she's a witch, but she also doesn't say she's a witch either. So she's sent to this community within Gambia, Zambia, and she has to live with this collection of witches, and they're all tied down by this ribbon because they're afraid they're going to run away and fly away if they're not tied down. So they all got their own little ribbon, and they welcome her into the society. And it's a very unique film. It's very indie. It's beautiful. It's tragic. It's funny. It's kind of critiquing the culture that uses these witches, because you see certain scenarios where someone's been accused of stealing. They'll bring in the little girl and then they go, right, which of these men has stolen? And the girl has to decide. And there's a little bit of like, are witches a thing? Do they, you know, there's a little undercurrent with that, but it's played more for its realism. And these politicians, these judges, these police people, they're using and taking advantage of these poor women who have been judged to be witches there's one guy who's taking advantage of the girl, and he's criticized for it because she's a child. She's not an old woman like the rest of them. And he's married one of the witches, and she gets attacked because somebody sees she has one of these ribbons like rolled up in her car because they have to take it with them. And you know, we see this hatred and this, you know, misunderstandings that happen. But it's also like the witches in the community welcome the young girl, and she feels part of something, and you see her like come out of a shell and things like that. And it's a really beautiful film. It's tragic and it's funny. So there's a lot going on there, a lot to unpack. But I really, really enjoyed it. And it was definitely worth watching. And it's clearly something the director feels, you know, very strongly about. And again, I think it's a reflection of, you know, that culture and the way they view witches, and even to this day. But yeah, I definitely give it a go. I think it's on Netflix right
Sounds
now.
Sounds really good.
So if you want to give it a go.
Tomorrow.
Yes, there you go. There you go. But yeah, just you know, it'll take you on a nice journey. But it's beautiful, beautifully shot, wonderful, and it's a nice kind of insight into that culture. It's not all sad, it's not all funny, but it's kind of a mix of everything. But yeah, I really, really do recommend
it. That sounds really good. Mm-hmm.
Won a lot of awards as well.
Oh,
so.
Really?
Yeah, won a lot of awards. I think there was an Academy Award for Best Newcomer or something like that.
Wow.
I think so.
And
yeah,
not,
definitely give
not
it a
that
go.
Old either, really?
No, 2017. Yeah, so not that long ago. But yeah, wonderful, wonderful film. And again, it's kind of a nice lens of modern day kind of superstition and witches. Mm. So yeah, no, it's good.
I'm intrigued by the ribbon.
Mm. Yes, they've got these big ribbons that plays quite an important role in the film. The kind of this stuff, and again, it's interesting. I do recommend it. I don't want to spoil it.
Yeah,
there's a lot to it, and there's a lot of layers, and it probably isn't for everybody, I don't think. But if you're, you know, if you're after something kind of touching and real and steeped in, you know, the cultural aspects of that, definitely, I Am Not a Witch is for you.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Good. Okay, well, that's mine. So what's your next one?
What do you reckon?
What are you going to go for?
Scott's got his notes.
He's got his notes.
I'm just freestyling.
Freestyling.
Do you want to go with The Craft?
Go on, then.
Well, you've already talked about it, but go on.
One of my faves. Yes. Okay, so I think I saw it. So it's like 96, right? This film came out.
Yeah.
When I was about, I don't know how old I would have been. 7 or 8, maybe. So, like, moved city, moved to a new school, left all my friends, like, had a real big kind of upheaval, you could say, and kind of started at this new school, and it was terrifying. Like, it was pretty horrible, because you're kind of old enough to kind of, you've already made friends, and people have already formed friends, and people have known each other for a long time at, like, preschool and things. So I kind of started at this new school, and it was a good, in a good way. I like met one of my best friends on my first day, who I love very much, but also kind of spent a few years kind of navigating girl clique groups, which was a little bit traumatic, and kind of, yeah, that thing of kind of wanting to fit in, and, you know, this kind of hierarchy, I suppose, within the kind of friendship groups and stuff. But that classic thing of being accepted into a kind of girl group and getting invited to a sleepover was like a huge deal. And watching movies, like VHS movies, was like obviously, you know, the thing to do. It was like late 90s, I guess. And The Craft, I think it was like probably like a 15, I suppose. So it was kind of older.
Yeah, probably.
So it kind of felt, you know,
edgy.
And yeah, and it kind of had everything in it that I could kind of relate to, because in the story, the main character kind of moves to this new place. She's got, you know, so she's kind of trying to fit in, and she kind of meets these girls, and it's a little bit of, not initiation, but I guess it's kind of working out where she fits into the kind of new school group, and then like romantic things, because at that age you're kind of just starting to kind of like, you know, kind of get the feels for the guys and the guys for the girls and this kind of thing. So yeah, I remember like going to sleepovers, watching The Craft, but also thinking like, you know, I can relate to this person. Mm. She's like got a bit of trauma in her life or whatever, and she's kind of wanting to fit in. And yeah, but it obviously, it's kind of, first of all, the soundtrack's freaking amazing.
Yeah.
So that's great. The fashion is like, you could not, it was that perfect 90s. Like I was saying to Scott, I had the chokers, the like little skirts, the kind of platform shoes and the socks and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, so I kind of, because I'd already had like a little bit of a, I suppose like, I can't even think of the word. I really like the kind of spiritual side.
Okay.
You know.
You already had a kind of fascination with the culture anyway.
And this kind of combined like teenage coming of age film. Yeah. And like, it does touch on a lot of issues racism, but sort of self-harm and other things, I guess kind of abuse as well. So it kind of, like I was saying to Scott, I think I did have some friends where I'm sure we started like telling boys that we were putting spells on them and stuff, and they were just like, just thought we were ridiculous. But we were like, oh, they're like, they don't even know. We're just going to put like a spell on them. And like, I think it's this kind of, you know, you kind of, I don't think nothing really obviously worked or anything. And like, this is the first time.
How do you know?
Well, this is the first time I tried a Ouija board as well.
Okay.
I was deeply disappointed that nothing actually happened. And you know it yourself and you're like, you want to believe and the glass just doesn't move and you're like, oh, it's not done anything. So
Didn't believe enough, clearly. You need to really believe, fully give in.
Maybe I was also saying to Scott, I was getting the words the wrong way around, saying like, stiff as a feather, light as that probably didn't help with the spells. But I was telling Scott there was this one.
Yeah, feather's known for being really stiff.
There was this one particular girl at school who, I won't mention by name, she was really nasty and she was very...
I don't think she's listening, Lucy.
Well, you know...
If you want to name her, it's fine.
No, I won't name her. I won't name her shame. But she was particularly nasty and mean. And me and this other girl basically decided we were going to do... I don't know, we were going to put a spell on her or something.
Curse, hex.
Hex. Although I don't think we did. And I think my friend just resorted to getting a big bit of chalk and drawing a picture of her on the street and calling her like a pig face slut or something. But she did happen to live not too far away and she walked up the street and realised it was aimed at her.
Really?
And like, knocked on the door and was
That must have, been some artwork because she realised that was her.
I mean, we lived in quite a small town, so I think, but just ridiculous stuff like that. Back to the film, I think... Yeah, I think it's got everything in it that's kind of, you know, the boy relate, you know, you have that relationship where you get close to a boy and you kind of get a bit of attention and they spread a horrible rumor about you and everyone's kind of whispering about it and it's horrible. And I feel like a lot of people can kind of relate to that.
Yeah.
But
people have skin conditions, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. I do like how they kind of, I like that they form a kind of nice bond and they have this kind of sisterhood and it's like northeast south best type stuff and then you see them like having their sleepovers and they're doing the kind of stiff as a feather light as a but then it starts taking a bit of a turn and you know stuff starts kind of going a bit wrong. I just think it's great. I think it's got some real creepy bits in it. But also when you look at it, it's like very nostalgic for me. Like I feel like there's real 90s like nostalgia in there, which I love.
Yeah, it is very, very 90s. Good cast as well. Really good cast.
Yeah, very good. What do you think? We've watched it twice, I think.
Yeah, well, I think we watched it last Halloween at some point, and that was the first time I'd seen it. And obviously I didn't have that nostalgia for it that Lucy has. So, wasn't particularly bowled over by it, I'd say. It is very 90s and, you know, some of the special effects are a bit dodgy nowadays. But I think, if I'd watched it when it was fresh and if I was a teen, then I'd appreciate it more. But, yeah, it's all right. I think just having seen something like Mean Girls, which...
Yeah.
Yeah, obviously that's sort of comedy teen rather than sort of horror.
Sure.
But I just think, that did it a lot better with the whole cliquey thing. And it's different.
Yeah, right? It's kind of almost a parody on films like The Craft, isn't it? In a sense, is going, you know, these are the tropes of this high school genre, let's poke fun at them and stuff. So I saw it again when I was quite young, so I had quite a kind of fondness for it, and there was a lot of people, like boys and girls, kind of dug it, I think. And it was kind of, I think it was probably like kind of like a gateway goth film. I think there's a lot of people that kind of went into like the goth lifestyle and the goth like aesthetic, I think, based on that, because it is kind of dabbling on those kind of gothic, or what goths would be, you know, kind of nowadays, and those, and back in the 90s as well. So yeah, I had a fondness for it. I did rewatch it not so long ago, and I don't think I'm as fond as I was when I initially watched it, but I don't hate it either. I think it's got some, like you said, it's exploring some interesting ideas, like Ben Stiller's wife is a racist. so she's in that. But again, yeah, there's a lot of kind of tropey things, and but I think for a lot of people, that a lot of women, I think, especially in the 90s, that was a very kind of coming of age thing, or they found something to relate to, or you know, they found sisterhood or some feminine power there where maybe it wasn't there before. And again, they obviously take it too far and people die, and it's weird to see, it's almost like Scream adjacent a little bit, because I think Scream came out the same year. Yeah. You've got Skeet Ulrich's in there, and you've got Neve Campbell's in there as well. So it's kind of interesting to see that. But yeah, really good cast. Soundtrack is very 90s. You know, I think for people maybe like, you know, Generation Z or Z, whatever, I think for them, if they go back, I think they might be like, oh, this is cringe because it's so 90s. But for me, I'm like, nah, 90s is fine for me. You know,
I feel like it's got some quite kind of, you know, there is a kind of, I think, you know, the fact that you talk about Ben Stiller's wife, like she's like it's got racism, obviously, pretty hard, obviously very harsh. But then obviously you've got like Sarah, who's like who's obviously got this like self-harm. And I think Nancy's character, you know, she's got this kind of trailer home life with her mum, who's kind of with a nasty sort of stepdad. And that's really horrible. And then I also think it's quite dark when Sarah kind of puts this spell on this guy as a kind of payback thing for like the nasty things he said about her. And he kind of becomes like infatuated with her and, you know, like over the top. But then essentially it's kind of like a pretty much almost like a rape scene, really, you know, and it's just...
Nancy turns into her and...
He also like turns up at her house and shouting her and stuff, and then like he says like, "Oh, come out for, you know, dinner with me," and he just kind of takes her to these like woods or whatever. And I just kind of feel like when you're, maybe I kind of watched it when I was like 10, maybe 9 or 10. Like, you know, although you don't know exactly things that are going on, you start to kind of go, wow, this is like,
that could happen.
There's dangerous situations, and obviously there's like dark things going on, and I think it just kind of makes you a little bit,
it's kind of a modernization of kind of a lot of the witch themes and stuff, and again being the outsiders again and not fitting in and trying to find your, like you said, your people, your crew, your coven, whatever you want to call it. And again, it starts off light and fun and airy, and they're all having their blast. But, you know, the more they dabble in the dark arts, the worse and worse it gets. But I think it does touch on a lot of kind of, again, like a lot of those issues probably wouldn't have been brought up before, really, in film, and not maybe in such a way and presented in such a way. So I think it's, I like it. I have fond memories of it. And yeah, is it perfect? No. Is it, you know, a masterpiece? But I think it hit at the right moment when it did, and I think for the people it hit with, it really was quite a seminal film for them.
Yeah. One interesting fact I read about it is I really don't like snakes at all, and there's obviously like a scene at the end where they have these snakes, but I read that they bred a load of cockroaches and had like a closed set so that they couldn't escape, but they were like cockroaches that couldn't reproduce. Like they bred them specifically so that the cockroaches couldn't reproduce, so that they wouldn't like escape and stuff, or like they wouldn't, which I thought was pretty, I don't know if they do that now, like if is that's like an animal welfare,
I mean, I guess it's probably like a pest control type of thing, isn't it? Yeah. They don't want just a ton of them escaping and going elsewhere.
They also had like 2,000 snakes or something. Like it was, well, maybe not 2,000, maybe that was the cockroaches. But anyway, they had a hell of a lot of snakes on that set, and like a really close set, but which just gives me the absolute ick, because I cannot think of anything. Like it's bad enough just seeing like a couple, but yeah, I cannot imagine who was responsible for filming all of that. And I just,
the snake wrangler.
I just, yeah, no thanks. That's like, oh, I can't think of anything worse. So maybe not. Maybe I'm not a true witch at heart, because I can't.
Maybe Scott's.
This.
Maybe Scott's just dating Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
In love with Indiana Jones. Exactly. That's what it is. You just need a hat now. That's it. Why did it have to be snakes? my next choice is V from 1967. So this is the very first horror film released in the USSR.
Really? The
very first. I think they got away with it because it's more of a kind of a folk tale. It's like a kind of a legend. It's based on a novel by Gogol. He was like a poet, Russian poet and writer. And it's quite an interesting concept. It's a kind of loutish, womanizing, hard drinking priest who's, you know, he's learning to be, he's at priest school, a seminary or whatever you call it. And he's learning to be, and he's just an awful person, like just out and out, just an idiot. He's, you know, he's an absolute, like, lagerlau, idiot, horrible, horrible person. Not likable in the slightest. He goes out one weekend after school's out. They get drunk and he tries to find somewhere to sleep. They get lost in the woods and they find this hut. And this old woman is there and she's cranking old. They're like, oh, let's say, you old stupid hag, let's stay in your place. And she's like, all right, then, fine. You stay here, you stay here, and you stay here. And she takes the lead character to the barn. And he's trying to settle down, get to sleep. He's a bit drunk. And this old woman starts trying it on with him. Starts trying it on. And he's like, get away from me, you horrible, ugly old hag. And then all of a sudden, she bewitches him. And then, as you were talking about brooms, we know stereotypically witches ride brooms. She doesn't ride a broom. She flies him into the sky and rides him, like sits on his shoulders and is flying around with this. She's holding a broom, I believe, or a stick or staff of some kind. Eventually, and he starts enjoying it. He's like, wow, this is amazing. And then he starts getting worried again. And then he's like, no, this is pretty cool. And then they land. And then immediately he starts beating her to death. He starts trying to kill her because he's like,
with the brooms? With
the staff, I think, or a stick he finds. He just beats her. Until she dies. When she dies, she turns into this beautiful young woman. And she's just in her last breaths, like, and he runs off and he escapes. And it takes him all weekend to get back to his seminary. And they're like, where have you been? What have you been doing? I don't know what's been going on. He's like, and he literally gets back. And the second he gets back, he gets a message that somebody needs him for some religious work. And it turns out that the young woman or the hag or the witch that he killed is the daughter of a high-standing public figure. And what they've done is she asked him to read her kind of last rites for 3 nights. He has to stay with her and he reads out all of these things, make sure she gets off nice and cleanly to the afterlife. And her father asks, and he's like, well, I've got nothing to do with this. I'm not a priest. I'm not. Why am I going there? I don't know. And he knows that it's this woman he's killed. Like, he knows. So he has to go. He's forced to go. The guy there, he's like, the dad there is like, this is her last wishes. How do you know her? And he's like, I've never met her before. I couldn't possibly have ever met her. I don't know what you're talking about. Drink, drink, drink. You know, and then he's in there that first night and he's like, oh, this is going to be boring. I can't believe I'm doing this. And then all of a sudden, she comes to life. She flies out of her coffin and tries to attack him. And he manages, through faith, to build up like an invisible, impenetrable shield. It's very, very weird. He manages to survive the night, and then the same thing happens again the second night, and then the third night as well. And it's a bizarre mixture of kind of comedy and horror, and I think we didn't really get that at this kind of time in the late 60s. It's got a very Evil Dead vibe. Like, it's when it's scary, it's really scary, and then when it's funny, it is quite funny. And he's like trying to protect himself, and he doesn't really believe in God or anything like that, but seems to be protecting him for the most part. And there's a moment where the witch, I think it's the second night, where the witch is kind of riding her own coffin like a surfboard around this room.
Amazing.
She summons like werewolves and zombies and demons, and she's trying to, and the physical acting, the special effects, the way they film it, the way they've just, the cinematography, it's all really amazing. And it feels like a almost like a live stage production. Very colorful, very unique, very interesting. I highly recommend it. It is available on YouTube in full in HD. Go and watch it. It's a little over an hour, but it's a blast. It's an absolute blast. That is V. It was remade as well in 2014. I've not seen that version, so I don't know what that's like, but absolutely recommend that. If you're a fan of anything like Sam Raimi-esque, like Drag Me to Hell, maybe something like that.
Yeah, you did show us the trailer just before we started recording, and it does look really good.
Is this the 3D one?
No, not the 3D. The 67 one. So that's the 2014 one. But yeah, go with that one first, and then if you like that, then I believe the 2014 is a slight remake. I think they only use, because it's quite a short book or novel, I think. They only use that section, but I'd give it a go. I think there's fun to be had there.
Definitely.
And again, it's like a different cultural approach to the witch.
I had only in the short trailer that we saw. The thing that stood out for me was the priest's bowl haircut.
Yes,
yeah. Very strong look,
very monk,
which
very
also monk-esque. I feel like has made a big comeback recently, because there are a lot of
people
with this haircut.
I did see this picture of this young lad in like Ibiza with his bowl haircut recently.
It's a thing.
Yeah,
it's a whole thing. Like it, yeah. But that really stood out for me. I'll definitely watch it.
I think I recommend it. It's a lot of fun. Again, it doesn't waste its time. It doesn't outstay its welcome. It's nice and short. You get exactly what you want from it. Again, I won't spoil it too much, but there's a lot of fun to be had. And just the kind of, even just like marveling at the way they do the special effects or trying to figure out how they did it, even back then, it's a lot of fun.
It's on the list for sure.
Yeah,
definitely. What's next for you guys then?
Maleficent.
Interesting. Mm. Interesting choice.
Yeah. So do we need to say that we realise that in some circles she's technically could be classed as a fairy, but we think she's a sorceress?
I mean, there's...
She puts a curse on.
Yeah.
So
in the, obviously, the original Sleeping Beauty, she's more of a sorceress slash witch.
Yeah, and she curses the baby.
And I think in some circles there's like the succubus, which is like the seductive half demon or partial demon. And I think there's a lot of witches who are like part demon anyway. So I think it's kind of all in the same wheelhouse. Yeah. I'll allow it.
Excellent.
Yeah, so I really wasn't expecting to like this as much as I did.
Hmm.
I was quite surprised. So I'm not a big fan of Sleeping Beauty.
Okay.
It's one of the Disney films that I wouldn't watch normally if it's on.
Hmm.
But there's some like The Lion King and Sword in the Stone, Pinocchio, that if it's on, then you'd watch the remainder of it.
Sure.
But yeah, Sleeping Beauty never caught my eye. So I think Lucy was watching this with her next door neighbour about five, 6 years ago.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. I don't know why. Maybe he was locked out.
Possibly.
I think
he's having a roast.
I think maybe he sort of saw it on Netflix or something. And
I think he likes Disney. He does like Disney films. Okay. So we were having a bit of a weekend.
Yeah. So we thought we'd give it a shot. And it was really good. Hmm. Obviously, Angelina Jolie playing Maleficent. And I think she does a brilliant job. And it kind of looks like she's having a whale of a time as well. Yeah. Obviously very striking with her cheekbones. I think it's with the Disney remakes recently, they've got very lazy with them, but this, they actually tried something different. So obviously she's the evil witch in the original, but then they've twisted it to sort of, so we see her backstory, why she is the way she is, but then she's not portrayed as an evil witch.
No.
She does evil things, but she also does good things as well. So, they put a twist on the original film, which I think they've sort of lost their balls with all the recent remakes that they've been doing, and they've just been copy and pasting it. But yeah, I really didn't expect to like it as much as I did.
Yeah. I think there's a real real beautiful element that is that, you know, I don't know if it's kind of that like adopted kind of thing, is that like you can still love someone or something even though they're not your own, like they're not your child, but she kind of cares for this baby. Even she sort of starts calling it Beastie, which I really kind of like, but she can't help herself. She can't help herself but care for her, and she sees the kind of haphazard fairies sort of just making a bit of a hash of it and leaving the baby outside, and you know, and it's kind of, she's watching over her as she grows up, and she's at arm's length kind of caring for the baby and watching it grow, and then this kind of, this love sort of builds. And I just think that's a really powerful thing, that you can have so much love for someone who isn't your blood essentially. And I think that for me is, and it actually makes me cry, this film, like it, when we know she kind of gets to the end, and I think it's just so clever how it's this kind of, it just flips everything on its head of what we know about, or what we, when we were, you know, watching Disney films, and it's always like the prince kisses the princess and everything is perfect, and actually it just kind of flips all of that on its head, and Prince Charming isn't true love's kiss. Sorry, spoiler alert.
Spoilers, yeah.
Sorry, you should probably just
spoilers for Maleficent if you haven't seen that.
But she's just, yeah, she, and I think as well, I love that she's the queen of the fairy world. So she, in her own right, she's got her power and her place and her magic and this kind of stuff, and it's when these kind of two worlds collide a little bit. But it does, yeah, it kind of makes me cry, Maleficent. Yeah. It's a real, real beautiful moment when, you know, it's that kind of, that true love, I guess. Yeah. It's really sweet, like that unconditional love, I suppose. Yeah.
But I like that. I like that, again, you, like you said, it flips it. It's not the stereotypical, like, oh, here comes the bloke, here he comes to save the day. It's not, it's not the man's story. It's this story of kind of genuine, kind of female, feminine, non-romantic love. And you see her kind of melt,
right?
Because initially she's very nice, and then she's robbed of her wings, and again she becomes bitter, hard and bitter and twisted, and again so much so she's like, curse that child, you know. And but then even then, like in this version, it's very much like, I think if I remember rightly, in the Sleeping Beauty version, it's the fairies that stop it from being a death curse, but this, she changes her own mind and goes, actually, she'll just sleep. She'll just sleep forever. And then, like you said, the fairies are a bit useless in the Sleeping Beauty one, but then they expand that and make them even more useless in this to give Maleficent her kind of her power, I guess. But I think Angelina Jolie is great in this. Yeah. I think it's one of her standout performances. She clearly cared about the character in this interpretation. Mm-hmm. And like you said, she's putting on all the camp. You know, she's loving it's delicious for her. She's living deliciously in this film. Yeah. Like, she's absolutely loving it.
Especially towards the end, I think it's all her costume changes, and it's this sort of like tight black leather piece.
Oh, I bet you like that, Scott.
That was. Yeah. And then she sort of gets her wings back, and
there's like a real, almost like a bit of a Marvel moment.
Yeah, absolutely. It feels like a Marvel movie.
She goes from wearing like dresses to when she gets her wings back, and she's in that kind of great hall, and she just kind of stands up, and you just see her in this, like, so all of a sudden she's wearing like head to toe kind of black leather, but she's got pants, like as in like trousers on. She's not wearing a dress, and these wings sort of, this silhouette, and she just kind of like rises up and takes everybody out. And I was just, said to you, I was like, oh, it's like, that for me is like, she's a badass. Like, it's absolutely great.
Yeah, it's definitely going with that vibe of the she's the hero of this tale.
Yeah.
And absolutely, and she's powered up again. She's found who she is. She knows what she's fighting for. She's found herself. She's not this evil, dark. You know, she does try and lift the curse, but she knows it's like a permanent curse.
Yeah. Mm.
There's that moment where she's like, shit, it's not working.
Yeah.
So, yeah, no, I enjoy this as well.
It's a really good film, like, real have a lot of respect for Maleficent. It's great.
I do kind of wish she'd turned into the dragon, though, like in the original.
Yeah, I was sort of waiting for that moment. Like,
I can understand why they changed it, and I guess they don't want this woman to like. I guess maybe calling a woman a dragon is kind of an insult, I guess, or maybe like a sexist insult, maybe. So maybe that's why they were like, no, she's a fairy, she's more angelic, she's got the horns and everything. So I don't know, but I guess she needs someone to talk to. That's why the crow became a man.
Yeah,
I guess. But I felt that for me wasn't the. Again, it's not his story, but he's just kind of there. He's like, oh, I'm a friend. I'm the crow.
Yeah,
you know, it's not. It doesn't really add much for me. But
and Charlotte Copley, I think that's his name. He's not got much dimension to him, really. No. I don't think, and his accent's a bit.
Who's this? The king.
Scottish king.
Yeah, no.
Maybe not his best.
No.
Yeah, I was a bit disappointed.
That accent is like...
All over the show.
But yeah, Maleficent is star of the show, and we were also reading about how there's a little scene where you have Aurora as a little toddler, and the actors that they had for that, who were like 4 or 5... Mm. wouldn't go near Angelina Jolie in all her outfit.
Mm.
So in the end, they had to use her daughter.
Right.
That little scene where there's only like a few minutes or something, not even that. But I mean, she's pretty terrifying. Like if toddlers, I would be a little bit nervous around.
I might not be scared, but I'd definitely be intimidated by Angelina Jolie in any form.
It's like with those horns and like you can imagine her being pretty scary. So I thought it was quite cool.
I quite like the moment as well where she's like, do you know who I am? Like, do you know what I did to you? Do you know what the story is between me and your dad? And she's like, of course I know who you are. You're my fairy godmother.
Yeah.
Which is like, well, no, but she perceives her that way. And she's like, and that's one of the things that kind of makes her.
Because she has been watching over her throughout her whole life. And she's sort of, she has picked up on that.
Mm. She's magical. She's, you know, she's a fairy. Yeah. You know? Kind of makes sense, but yeah. Excellent choice.
Yeah,
excellent choice. So next up will be The Old Ways from 2020. So again, I've looked at another film that from a different part of the world and looking at how they view witches and witchcraft. So The Old Ways is a 2020 film, and it's about a young reporter who lived in this kind of Veracruz, in this kind of jungle area in kind of Mexico on the outskirts. And she lived there, but her mum was possessed by a demon or had a horrible medical condition, Skeptic Scott, whatever you want to see it as. And then she died and she moved away to the city and grew up there. She then became a reporter and a drug addict. And now she's coming back home to meet her cousin and to kind of find her roots again and investigate some stuff and just do some reporting about the kind of local culture and things and maybe superstitions and stuff. She visits a cave. Her cousin says, do not fucking go there. And she comes out of it and she's been possessed by a demon. Now, has she been possessed by a demon? Hard to say at the beginning. She is chained up in this hut and she's being taken care of by a bruja, which is kind of the Mexican form of the witch or the name for a witch. And she is attempting to exorcise this demon and her son is helping her. She's this very old woman, half blind, and she's basically torturing her for, you know, making her drink this goat milk, like force feeding her like goat milk and, you know, hurting her, putting needles and pins and stuff in her. And the woman just doesn't understand. She doesn't get it. She's like, I don't believe in this stuff. This isn't me. And they're like, well, you've forgotten who you are. You've forgotten what happened to your mother. You've forgotten the old ways. You've forgotten our culture, your heritage. You're very westernized and you view the world very scientifically. And now it's come to haunt you. So in this film, not only is she fighting her an actual demon that's possessing her, but she's fighting those personal demons she has and that trauma about her mother and what happened there. And it's really quite interesting, the kind of seeing the, again, a different side of that. And again, these characters at the beginning, the Bruja and the son that's assisting her, are kind of, you're looking at them as villains in the piece, because you're like, I don't believe in this shit. I'm just on drugs. I'm fine. It's fine. It's just drugs, you know. But they're like, no, you there's something inside you. There's an evil inside you. It's wanting to get out. And then they kind of bar up. There's all this stuff on the walls. And they have to try and pinpoint which kind of demon it is and work out what the problem is and how to get it out of there and what they've got. And then she studies it and starts learning about it as well, going like she starts to kind of buy into it and believe it. But then she's trying to escape as well because she's like trying to get a phone, trying to call her boss. So it's kind of a witch film meets kind of a exorcist film in a way. So there's a lot of this going on. But I like how the skeptic at the start becomes more and more, kind of understands more and knows more and kind of appreciates what they're doing. By the end, these people that have started off as seemingly abusers and the villains of the piece actually kind of become the heroes. In this tale, there's some really creepy, wonderful kind of special effects. It's very low budget. It also stars AJ Bowen, who I interviewed a few years ago at Grimfest. He's a lovely guy, right. Brilliant guy. So he plays the boss of the lead character. So yeah, so it's really interesting. I think that's also on Netflix at the moment, if you want to give that a watch.
What was that called again?
The Old Ways. The Old Ways. Yeah. So I recommend that one because, again, it's quite modern. And again, there's some special effects that don't hold up, you know, or don't come out that well. But by that point, I think by the end of the film, you're kind of bought into the whole thing and the aspects of it. And I do really like the kind of exorcism scenes and, like, you know, you're looking at dark corners, you're like, is there something there? Is something moving? Or, you know, there's a lot going on. But I thought it was a nice kind of, it was a nice kind of personal journey for that character. And also, like, investigating the culture of it as well and learning about that kind of the way they view witches, the way the Mexican folklore is and the South Central and South American folklore is about witches. So, yeah, definitely recommend that one as well.
Sounds good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. What's next for you guys?
What's on the list? Practical magic.
Practical magic.
Oh, you know it.
Okay.
Absolutely amazing. Okay, so I've seen this film like loads and loads and loads, but we did watch it quite recently.
Yeah, I watched it for the first time yesterday.
And Scott was, yeah, in hindsight, like, now watching it now, it's pretty cheesy. It is cheesy. But I think for me, I love that it's about sisters. So, like, I have a sister and I feel like there's a real strong bond there when you have, like, I don't know if other people feel like this, but real sister love, sister protection and kind of, yeah, like there's a real kind of, I love that you've got the kind of the aunties and the kind of then the sisters and then the daughters, and it's just that's a real kind of strong love, I think, that I sort of have, can sort of, you know, empathize with there. I mean, it's great. Like, it's got everything. Like, it's got this beautiful island, this fantastic like house, these kooky aunts who don't give a crap about what anyone thinks in the town. You've got these girls who have their own kind of personalities, are a bit different, but really strong bond there, really protective bond. And then this kind of curse about the males and this kind of how males kind of interact with, well, you know, like their kind of relationships with men, I guess. I mean, what's not to love? It's just,
come on, great. Scott, what's not to love
what's
about
not
practical
to love
magic?
About practical magic.
I do think that the two leads, so Nicole Kidman and Sandra Bullock, I think they are very good and their chemistry together is brilliant. But You know, sometimes when you're just not particularly enjoying a film and then you're just looking for to pick holes in it.
Yeah.
Things that don't entirely make sense with the plot.
What?
You just sort of think, oh,
like...
man, that doesn't...
Oh, okay, all right. Hang on.
Well, fairly early on, it's sort of the main part of the film, I guess. So Nicole Kidman's witch has sort of gone off and is living her own life, you know, a bit of a wild child.
Yeah.
And she's met this guy who's abusive to her, and Sandra Bullock then goes and saves her. But in doing so, they end up killing the guy. And there's a massive panic about what they're going to do with the body. And so they decide, right, we'll drive him home to ours, and we're going to resurrect him so that we haven't killed him. And so they drive him home to their house. They do a resurrection spell. He comes back from the dead, but he's not quite himself. He's sort of in almost an even more evil version of himself. And then they kill him again. And then they just think, oh, well, we'll just bury him in the garden now. And I was just thinking, well, why didn't you do that in the first place? And now there's this massive curse, and he's like a ghost, and he's causing all these weird things to happen in the house, and people to be unwell, and people to get
possessed
and all that. And so, yeah, it's just one of those things. Well, you could have just buried him the first time, and then you wouldn't go through any of it. But then they kill him again, and they're not as asked about, oh, what should we do with the body now? Yeah, anyway, it's just one of those things that gets in your head, and then you think, oh, God.
I do understand. I understand. Mm. I feel like they were giving him a chance. Mm. And, you know, strike one. We'll try again. Strike two. No, you're out.
I think I was speaking to Rhea Carrigan, who's a friend of mine for the Femon Pod, and she really likes this film as well. And she said this is a film about imperfect women being allowed to be imperfect. So maybe in a male-led franchise, if someone made this many mistakes, we would be okay with it, maybe, or we would be like, oh, well, he's doing this and doing that. But these women are, you know, they want to fall in love, they want to get with people, with men, but even though they might die, and then they're making up perfect men to make sure none of them die. And I like the kooky aspect of the ants and things. Again, I don't think I went in with, I went in with absolutely like no idea of what it was going to be. I'd seen trailers in my early days, and it looked like a kind of shitty rom-com of some kind. I was like, I'm not buying this. But actually, this is kind of quite dark and quite edgy in some ways. And, you know, I thought it was a lot more than what I was going to get. But I like the fact that, you know, the women, most of the women in the town are initially quite, you know, like, oh, they're outsiders, they're weird, they cause men to die, all this sort of shit. But by the end, the whole town is kind of, spoilers, you know, they come to assist them, and it's there. Like, we have this detective character who comes in and falls in love, but he's not like, he doesn't save the day. It's not his film. Because the town, even the people that absolutely hate each other and they're like, oh, I don't know about this, but they say, this woman's in trouble, there's a man trying to hurt her, we've got to help her. And they all go, yeah, of course. And they come together and they solve it. And then, you know, and they then become like the tourist attraction for the town at Halloween, you know, they're jumping off the roof and stuff. So I think Rhea has a really strong point there. I think that, you know, we maybe expect women to do this and be this and act like this. So I think this film kind of allows them to be quite, you know, I knew for a fact, I was like, Nicole Kidman's going to be in trouble. Like from day one, I was like, she's going to get in some horrible trouble, and Sandra Bullock's going to have to come and save her.
I think as well, like, there's that real, there's like a real pain, like, what we see for Sandra Bullock's character. You know, she's lost her husband.
Yeah, love of her life.
And she, you know, you see her like she's lying in bed and she can't get out of bed.
Yeah, like
the kids, the girls are kind of coming in and saying, like, mummy, you know, you're going to get up and stuff. And I feel like that's a real, that's like a real raw, you know, there'd be a lot of women who kind of, there are days that I'm sure, like, you know, you have to be a mom and you have to go to work and you have to do these things. And it's like, there's days that actually you do just lie in bed and you don't brush your teeth and you don't brush your hair and you just want to cry and you can't shake that. And I feel like that's like a real rawness and a real pain of like love and loss and things like that. And then, you know, it's this kind of thing of like her sister kind of comes and says like, I'm here with you and, you know, I'm going to lie here with you and you need to brush your teeth and you're going to take care of these girls.
We're going to die together. We're going to be all, you know.
Like, you know, and there's that real bond that I think is just really powerful. And I think it's just, and I think, like you say, it's that vulnerability and that women not, it's not that perfect. It's not, you know, and she's kind of, she feels like she's not the perfect mum because all the other mums in the village don't put her at the top of the phone tree.
Exactly,
And then her sister kind of comes in and makes that happen. Mm. And, you know, and I feel like that must be like a real society, you know, like a real acceptance thing within mums being this perfect, you know. She just says that she, you know, she wants to have that normal life. She doesn't want her girls to do magic. She wants to have a normal life with the husband and it just... it doesn't work out and, you know, it doesn't happen like that. Although I think in the end that does kind of happen because she meets... Although I will say about the cop who's lovely, spoiler alert.
Yeah, spoiler alert, he is lovely.
He is lovely. He mumbles a lot.
He does.
And I wish he just... and he's got this like Johnny Cash kind of like southern
drawl.
Arizona. Yeah. And I'm like, you what? Say what? He's like a, you know, anything.
Better get yourself a lawyer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he's lovely, obviously. Yeah. He's lovely. But yeah, I was also really scared by Jimmy, the character that. Mm.
Yeah, very intense.
He's very violent, very.
Was it Angel Love? Is it Angel Love or something like that?
Yeah. Like,
it's like, oh, it's Bulgarian. I was like, it doesn't sound Bulgarian to me.
And then she's like, oh, he lives near Transylvania. And I was like, are they near each other? I don't know. Anyway, but yeah,
that scene where they do bring him back to life, and it's some sort of weird color thing they've done with him.
It's scary.
Yeah,
it's effective. Really good. Yeah, I thought when he comes out of the body. And
yeah,
like, but also he's. I feel like he's terrifying when he obviously abuses her and he gets that.
When he doesn't let her go to the toilet by herself. No, like, you're like, oh God, here we go.
And,
yeah.
And like,
he's going to brand her with the ring.
Like, I remember feeling like, and she has to obviously like drug him just to, and they joke about the fact that she drugs him just to get some shut eye. Yeah. And they sort of laugh it off a bit, but her sister's like, is
that... But then again, it being imperfect, you know, she shouldn't really be doing that, really. No. But what I quite liked as well is that we think because he's been murdered, the abusive guy, that the cop is coming to get them to find out where he's gone, because it's the man's disappeared, the famous rock star's disappeared.
Yeah.
But actually, he's looking for him because he's an abuser of women.
And he's done it before.
And he's done it before, and he's done the branding. And again, it's like the house and the curse is like trying to put them in it, because it keeps like throwing stuff at him and like the ring and stuff. And the little girls, I think the daughters in it are really good as well. And they're part of that kind of that sisterhood as well. And that,
I think one of them's Evan Rachel Wood.
Yes,
I
mean, yeah.
Who's that?
So she's an actress.
Red-headed girl. I'm thinking it.
I can't remember. I can't remember what she's. Can't think of something.
She's in Westworld, the TV. Doris. Is it Doris?
Really?
I think so.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah, she's been in a lot of stuff. She was tied to Marilyn Manson for a bit, and was one of the people that kind of revealed his not so good behavior, let's say.
Mm.
So, but yeah, right. Is there anything else you want to say about practical magic?
I just love it. I just love it. It's just great. I could watch it over and over again. Yeah. Doesn't get old for me, but I love it.
I think it's a film I didn't expect to be as good as it was, but I didn't go in with any expectations, I think. So I think I was quite pleasantly surprised when I got there, because I expected it to be rubbish because the trailers made it look rubbish. But I did read that it was supposed to be a lot darker initially, but they kind of added a lot more kind of humor to it and the way they played it and things came out. It's also directed by, you know, the zombie guy from Werewolf in London, American Werewolf in London.
Yeah.
He's the director. the best friend in that. He's the director, Griffin Dunn. Mm. So, yeah.
It's based on a novel, I think, isn't it?
Might be, yeah, I think so. It wouldn't surprise me, but yeah.
The only thing that I think is a bit cringe is when they do jump off the roof at the end.
Yeah, it is a little.
Mm.
I mean,
by that point, I'll be honest, I kind of checked out because you've vanquished the villain. You know, the town people like you anyway. You don't need to do this whole joke. So it's kind of like an in-joke for them anyway. It's like, oh, yeah, we jump off the roof at Halloween.
Yeah.
But then they actually do it.
Because then they kind of, I feel like what's nice about them is they don't have that
stereotypical.
Witchy. And then at the end, it's like, I mean, it's Halloween, so, you know, we can forgive them for that. But
it's kind of like a more mature Sabrina, I guess, because she's got a couple of aunts, hasn't she? So
I do also really enjoy that they wake up quite late and start having margaritas and then get on to
chocolate cake straight away for breakfast.
Tequila and chocolate for breakfast. Like, we know what's not to like. So yeah. 10 out of 10 for me.
Yeah, I think there's a lot to like here. I think even you know,
although
the ropey bits.
Can we just talk about this scene where Sandra Bullock runs down the road to that fruit man?
No, that's where it started to go.
That's where I was like, that's when I was worried because I was like,
sorry, have they never met before? And I was like, no, this is the thing. She's like, she's one minute she's gardening in her cowboy boots and her hot pants, and then she's like, oh. I'm just going to run to the fruit.
Was she at Hot Pants? Lucy, I don't know if you're remembering the film.
Denim.
Would you garden in Hot Pants, Lucy?
Hey, Dan, you watch it. Denim shorts.
Okay, denim shorts.
Little t-shirt, denim shorts, and cowboy boots. And she's just like running down the street.
Well, yeah, they sort of have a little glance at each other before.
Because she sort
and
of,
then she then goes off and then she sort of thinks, oh no, I'm going to... Yeah.
The answer bewitched her, though, haven't they? Slightly.
Yeah.
They're giving her a nudge.
Yeah, she's a bit wary of this curse, of course, that any person she falls in love with is going to die.
Eddie Owens, man.
But then I think she just goes, no, to hell with it, and runs down the road and just starts getting off with him.
And then they hear the Death Watch Beetle? They hear the Death Watch Beetle, and then she's trying to find it. She's like, he's going to die. And then she's like, oh, the curse happened. I fell in love with him. And the ants were like, we didn't know you were going to fall in love with him, even though you've got two kids. You know, we didn't know you're going to have true love. Oh, okay, thanks, I guess.
Yeah.
And that's when she's like, no magic for any of my kids. None of that.
But that's the cheesiest scene where she runs down the road. I love it. I love it so much. Mm. It's great.
Yeah, it's pure cheese. Yeah. That's when I was like, oh, it's going to be a shitty rom-com. It's going to be a shitty supernatural rom-com. But luckily, it wasn't that. So
there's a lot of
stuff to enjoy. Okay, so next up for me, Hansel and Gretel, Witch Hunters from 2013. So there's a few films that have a twist in the tale, like we've talked about. So this is a twist on Hansel and Gretel. So I'm going to describe how the... Now, initially, I went in going, "This, I think this is going to be a bit shit." And I was like, I think this is going to be a bit crap.
I remember seeing the trailers for it at the time, and yeah.
Yeah, it kind of looks like a raunchier Van Helsing a little bit, which it is, in a way. So the opening scene is Hansel and Gretel get abandoned in the woods by their father. They get found by the witch, and they get taken into the candy huts or whatever it is, the candy house, or made of sweets. And Hansel is being force-fed the sweets and, being stuffed. And the witch is like this horrible old crone. She's like, eat, eat. And then Gretel's trying to, stoke the fire in the oven. And she's like, make it hotter, hotter, hotter. And then eventually Gretel has enough and starts absolutely beating the shit out of the witch with like the fire poker and then puts it in the oven. And then she goes, hot enough for you, bitch.
I think I've seen it. I've seen this film.
And that's kind of a good trailer for the film because that is, you're off to the races. So these two children, they don't really know their origins and they learn that throughout the film a little bit. And they grow up to be bounty hunters, basically, of witches. So they go all around the world killing witches. And they're hired to kill a certain set of witches that have been kidnapping children because there is a blood moon ritual that the witches want to perform. It is a bit Avengery because it's got Jeremy Renner in as mm-hmm. as Hansel,
yeah.
And you've got Gemma Arterton as Gretel, and Famke Janssen of X-Men fame plays the lead witch. I can't remember her name. I think it's like Magdalene or something. And the makeup on the witches is amazing. You've got like this horned witch. The Famke Janssen one is very like stereotypical pointy chin, big nose, cracked skin, like these piercing blue eyes. And it is fun, it is foul-mouthed, and it is frenetic yes. and violent and everything you want. The kills, there's a massive troll man in it. It's brilliant. There's a lot of humor to it. There's a lot of just it's everything I kind of want in a film, and luckily it kind of caught me off guard again, like these films kind of do. They just catch me off guard. And I bloody really enjoyed it. It does kind of dip in the middle a little bit, I think, because I watched the unrated version, so it's a little bit longer. But right at the end of this blood moon ritual thing, that they're basically, it's to stop the witches from being vulnerable to fire, I think. They're trying to do that. They're trying to get rid of their weakness. Very Blade or something like that. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. You've got like, they string up like razor wire. So then the witches get on their brooms. They're just coming apart because they're hitting the razor wire. They've got all these wonderful traps and gadgets and things. Gemma Arterton's great. Gemma Arterton and Jeremy Renner inexplicably have American accents, even though they've grown up in like Germany and nobody else does. Bizarre, proper weird, but it's really fun. And then when you get to this big ritual at the end, spoilers, but you get all these witches from different cultures. There's like a witch with a giant tumor on her neck. There's a witch who's like a kind of African tribal witch doctor. So you get a wide range of all these different kind of cultures and different takes on witches. But it's an absolute blast. There's not much to say on it. Just check it out. You know, go in with a kind of a tongue-in-cheek attitude, and I think you'll quite like Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters.
I think I've seen it, and I thought it was great. I was pleasantly surprised. Like, it is all of those things.
It is, absolutely. 100%. Roses are red, violets are blue, but the iris is the flower. That will mean the end of it.
You can run from Suspiria. Suspiria. You can hide from Suspiria. Suspiria. But you cannot escape. The only thing more terrifying than the last 12 minutes of Suspiria are the first 92.
Okay, so we're back after our toilet break, and this time we're talking about your top number one. Which film is this? Have you been going in like order of preference? Is this number one for being the best one? Or
my picks, I guess the first and the last one were my favourites.
Yeah,
so. I mean this next one is an absolute classic, and we've probably watched it a lot, like over the year. Like I think in our childhood, I certainly have anyway. Mm-hmm. But yeah,
absolutely terrified me as a kid.
Yeah,
as I'm sure it did a lot of people, and that's The Witches, based on Roald Dahl, of course.
Mm-hmm.
What to say? Well,
what hasn't been said about The Witches?
It's Angelica Houston, one of the greatest kids' film performances, I think, ever, especially as a villain.
Yeah.
You know, she just steals the show, doesn't she? But yeah, very terrifying. I mean, that whole, just to jump straight into that whole about 15-minute conference room sequence, one of the scariest things I remember from my childhood. Obviously, you get the reveal of what the witches actually look like. And I think it's Jim Henson who did the puppetry.
Maybe. Yeah, maybe. I wouldn't be surprised.
I think it was. Then the transformation of the kids into mice. I've watched it again today, and it's terrifying. They're just sort of shaking, and then they've got the mice ears, and then the green smoke coming out of their mouths, and oh, it's horrible.
I think the for me, the that going back to that kind of mundane thing is that the grandma, you know, she's wonderful grandma. He, you know, he's lost his parents in the, sorry, spoiler alert.
Yeah, spoilers again, spoilers.
In case anyone's not seen it, but I imagine a lot of people have. You know, he's kind of a bit orphaned, but he's got this wonderfully loving grandma who's looking out for him, but also teaching him about these kind of German, I think she's got a German background or something.
Yeah,
so she's kind of teaching him about these stories. But what I absolutely love is that she's, you know, it's that notion that these witches are everyday women who look very well to do, who, you know, dress well, their children smell like poo to them or whatever. But I love that for a while I would like walk down the street and I'd see like a solitary woman, a well-dressed woman coming towards me or walk it, and I'd think, oh my God, she's one of them. She's one of them.
How like, sexist of you, Lisa. I like judging just, other women.
I just, but they, you know, this is what, you know, this is the kind of story. Mm. But I just thought there's this kind of power there and this kind of like, they blend in very well, but they've got these really ugly feet. And so they'll always be wearing tights and shoes. And I just, but and the, I think the scene for me that is, I think the scariest scene is when the story about the girl who disappears into the painting.
Oh yeah, I like that.
Mm. And also, so my dad is actually a painter and we have loads of paintings around the house, but the idea that someone could disappear into a painting and would change, you know, the painting would change. And I just, that, I thought that was really like harrowing actually, like a really horrible thing that you could see this girl and she would kind of change in the painting, but she was trapped in this painting and then eventually she kind of disappears. And I just thought, oh my God, that's like, what a horrible curse to be in, something that you can see but you can't do anything about, and yet she's kind of living like
being in an iron lung or something, I guess.
Yeah, just
trapped, visible but lost and trapped without,
exactly. Mm-hmm. And this kind of, and because it's a painting, it's kind of almost like very innocent and kind of, you know, It looked right and it felt right, but the fact that this daughter, I think it was like a girl.
Yeah, it was a daughter.
She, you know, and her, so like her parents would kind of look at this painting and see her there. And I just thought, oh my God, like that's like messing with my mind. Like it's horrible.
But also I think it's kind of saying as well, like how many times do you walk past a painting in your house, but you don't truly look at it as well. And again, they would have found her. Maybe there was something they could do if they just only looked at that painting just a little deeper as well. Kind of very, very cosmic horror, I guess. There's a lot of kind of elements there, but
very dark.
Yeah.
But I like, just everything about it, and a little bit of a personal fact about it. So we actually went to a wedding a few years ago that was actually at that hotel.
No way.
Yeah, the Headland Hotel in Cornwall. A stunning hotel, like absolutely beautiful red brick building on the cliffs. And so my friend and like a really close friend of mine got married there, and they'd kind of gone on holiday there, and also because it's like Cornwall, it's kind of like surfery and things like that, but they'd got a lot of memories of kind of going for walks on the beach and stuff, and they were like, we're getting married in this hotel, and it's actually the hotel that The Witches was filmed at. And I was like, no way, this is amazing. And we turned up and the weather was actually terrible. Like it was very stormy and rainy and blustery and all this sort of stuff. But we managed to get some photos outside after the wedding, when there was a little bit of sunshine, and we had our photos taken. There's a scene where there's a lady with a baby in a pram on the cliff, kind of on the cliffs at the back of the hotel.
A witch pushes the pram down,
and it rolls off. And so, like, we had our photos taken kind of just about there. But that's also like really dark and sinister as well. But that, like, the corridors, the
baby murder is, I think, yeah.
Yeah, but like, yeah, it was beautiful. We had a great wedding. The kind of long corridors are exactly as you'd see.
That must have been so surreal. So surreal. Cool.
I think the actual, like you were talking about the conference room. I think
yeah,
that
and
was
the dinner
somewhere.
Room.
I think that was in a set.
Yeah,
that was
probably.
So it wasn't actually where we were sat down for dinner, but it was kind of cool.
Nice.
It was really cool.
I think maybe, like, again, it's that modernizing of the kind of witches, like, legend and stuff. And I think maybe that those scenes are when the witches are all taking their wigs off and they're, you know, revealing their true forms, and that they're just underneath all this kind of makeup and stuff, they're just as hideous as they are inside. I don't know if maybe that's saying something about, like, female beauty standards, or, you know, the perceived, you know, because they're trying to put on this front and this mask and walk around, you know, society undetected, or, you know, protected by that kind of makeup and stuff. I don't know if maybe that's their true evil forms showing.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that's something they're trying to say. Could just be reading too much into it as well.
Mm. I really liked how the Grand High Witch has this kind of, she looks great, like she looks amazing, this kind of like, she looks kind of sexy, I suppose, kind of like, you know, off the shoulder number, very kind of
red lipstick,
classically kind of really strong haircut, really like quite curvy features and all the rest of it. But I also love that she's got shit ton of money. She's like, and I love that there's just like, what is it, like, not gold bars, but like absolute dollar. And I'm like, not only is she like a bad witch, but she's fucking loaded. And I love that. And I love that they're like, not like, there's this kind of money is also tied up in this kind of witch culture, and they have all these conferences. Like, they're so rich, they can hire out this hotel conference room and have, like, you know, talk about the sweets and the potions. And I'm like, they've got all the money. They're great. They've got the power, the money. Yes, this is what we want. So I kind of quite like that.
Yeah. I miss like kids' films that had edge, you know, that took risks, that kind of scared you. Like, you know, I think the films that we have now are like, they're obviously for a different audience and different things, and obviously you don't want to scar kids and stuff. But I think kids being scared is, you know, it's fine. Like, just,
they're going to be scared anyway.
Yeah, there's scarier things than a witch. Yeah. You know, what about unemployment, depression? They're going to have to deal with all of those. You know, those are real horrors.
Money issues.
Those are the real horror movies out there, not these supernatural kind of characters and stuff. So I think, you know, scare kids, you know, we're all fine, aren't we, to a degree?
I was absolutely terrified of that. That whole long scene where they're transforming into the witches and then the mice. But I watched that film about 50 times as a kid, and I'd watch that a bit over and over and be terrified each time.
I was terrified of Maleficent when I was a kid in Sleeping Beauty, when she turned into a massive dragon. But it's one of my favourite bits in any Disney film. You know, I was terrified of the Rancor when that comes out in Return of the Jedi. Like, I was scared of that, you know. Again, that, because it made an impression on me, because I had an emotional, you know, connection to it. And I think it's the same, like you said, with the witches. Like, you know, you remember those moments and those things. Like, you know, Never-Ending Story, where the horse drowns, you know, spoilers. You know, that's horrible. It's really sad, but you remember it for those reasons. And again, it's not like, you don't remember it and going, I'm glad that horse fucking died. You know, you're not a psychopath. You're going, no, I felt a genuine human emotion. That's a good thing. If I didn't feel anything, I'd be worried. But yeah, absolutely. I think we need more kids films that take risks and you know, push the envelope, because to what a kids film should be, I think. But I don't know if we're going to get those. Or
definitely Roald Dahl was like, you know, he was kind of, he's like a real master of that. Like, you can make a kids film be like horrible and address all these issues, but still sort of, it's still for the kids, like, you know, and it kind of sits with you and you remember it. And it's like, Matilda's the same thing, you know, pretty harrowing details of like
child abuse,
neglect and things like this. But it's like,
the chokey.
But somehow it's like, you can't look away, but ultimately the good does triumph for evil. And you know, and I think this, like,
it's more satisfying because the evil is so evil and so dark and so scary. When it does, when you do triumph over it, it's like, yeah, we have accomplished something.
And I think as well, the lovely grandma in The Witches, you know, she's kind of a little bit frail, a little bit old, but, you know, her grandson kind of, he's there to kind of, he will look after her. They have each other. Yeah. And he, you know, and I feel like even though she's...
Well, she's diabetic too. I forgot to mention Hansel and the witch.
Oh, no way!
Because Hansel's eating the candy, he becomes diabetic and has to keep injecting himself.
No,
and she's diabetic in the film as well.
That's
quite
hardcore. Yeah, like, it, you know, I kind of feel like it's this...
It's really sweet at the end when he's still a mouse and she's got that sort of toy train set. I wished I could be a mouse when I was a kid, just so I could have a toy train set to ride around in.
Yeah.
Even though it's so tragic that he's got turned into a mouse, but she still loves him. And she was still
and he's like, oh, it's all right, Grandma.
Yeah.
You know.
Stop the witches, end of the day, they did.
Yeah.
You know, there are, you know, he could be dead or, you know, or like does the other boy get eaten or killed or something? Or is he okay in the end?
Oh,
he gets...
What's his name?
He loves food. He cannot stop talking about food.
I was going to come to Bruno.
Bruno, that was it.
Yeah.
And he's got those Scottish parents, like...
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, he's always eating.
Yeah, even as a mouse, he keeps... trying to find food.
And she puts them in his handbag and then goes to dinner. And
back in the days when we laughed at childhood obesity. The good old days.
Yeah. But it's like, it's such a good film. Mm. And also, I have watched the Anne Hathaway version as well.
You have? Okay, yeah. Any good?
Some people sort of didn't like it. Like, I thought she did great. I thought it was great. I thought it's just very, you know.
Robert Zemeckis.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I liked it. Yeah, I had no issue.
I think there was a bit of controversy on some of the designs of the witches, I think.
Right. Yeah.
Similar to some people that have certain, you know, disabilities or physical issues. Yeah. I think there was some controversy there. But, I haven't seen it myself, so I can't comment on whether it's good or not. But I might give it a go eventually. But, anything else you want to say about the witches?
No, I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that's a solid choice. I think a lot of people will agree with you. Okay, my final one is one I mentioned earlier. Again, one we watched, Suspiria.
Yes.
So it is Dario Argento's giallo slasher memory. He likes playing around with memory, like repressed memory. But it is probably the most gorgeous horror film you've ever seen. The most colourful, the most vibrant. All the while being one of the most brutal and devastating, and has one of the best soundtracks of a film ever by a band called Goblin. How appropriate. It is a story of a young American dancer who's going to a German dance school, and she turns up, something very odd happens. A girl goes missing and she is killed. Two girls are killed very brutally, and a lot of gruesome gore, very 70s gory stuff. Lucy really enjoyed it because a lot of doors and windows opened, and that's what terrifies Lucy.
Mm-hmm.
Every single time any doors or windows open, it wasn't what was behind the doors or what was coming through, it's just the fact that something opened and she would scream, and I loved it. And I think it was one of the best ones to show Lucy because we were talking about it all the way through. We were talking about the set design, the colour, the lighting, everything about the film, like still enjoying it and still keeping up with the story, but I absolutely adore it. It's cheesy, it's fun, the dialogue is like weird. There's like, I believe Susie and Sarah, I believe all girls with the name S are like snakes. Very bizarre stuff. You know, you've got all these very odd characters. You've got a helper who has kind of a waiter or handyman around there, has decided to pull out all of his teeth because he had gingivitis, and he's smiling at people with these really massive false teeth. It's like, it's kind of like Jaws from James Bond almost, kind of vibe going on. You've got some very strict kind of teachers and cooks and very odd children. And then there's a blind man who's playing piano and his dog attacks him because it's been bewitched by the witches. Spoilers, but it's about witches. It is so unique, and I don't think there's ever, ever going to be another horror film quite like it. But all of it comes together in such a weird way. It, on paper, it all really shouldn't come together as well as it does.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's something going on at this ballet school, and it's very odd, very strange.
Just remind me again.
Go on.
Is it like the school building that has this kind of like sort of
curse or something? Yeah, it's kind of, yeah, there's a coven of witches that run the school. Spoilers. And one of them is Helena Marcos, who there's a history of her going from school to school. And the more she kills people, the more money they accumulate, much like Angelica Houston.
It's all about the dollar.
Yeah, love that dollar. So they accumulate the wealth. And again, maybe that's something, again, like the patriarchal society doesn't want women to have power and money. That's another thing, maybe. But yeah, so that's the whole kind of plot of the film. And she's going to be one of the victims of the witches if she's not careful. And she slowly but surely uncovers some of the facts, because she remembers something from a stormy night where the girl went missing, and she's trying to bring back that memory, all the while all the people are going missing and dying in very unique and interesting ways.
What I remember from it is a lot of angles.
Yes.
Like a lot of like jaunty kind of camera angles. I don't know if it was like the cameras or the set, but
cinematography,
you were like, you're gonna love the set design in this, because it's very theatrical and obviously it's like a dance school and things like that. But yeah, I just remember these kind of very sort of stained glass.
Almost very like, German expressionist kind of, almost like very odd. Yeah.
But show me a corridor and a window with a bit of lighting behind it, and I've got my hands over my eyes.
It was funny. You didn't even see the stuff that came through or in and out of the windows because you were so scared.
No, it was just, that's enough for me.
It's effective. Like, again, it's like, you know, it's 40, 50 years old now, but you're still, you know, for you, like, you know, it's still effective to this day. And I love it. And it's still holds that power all these years later.
It's very vibrant, very dramatic.
Absolutely. Well, I won't go on any longer about Suspiria. I think most people probably would have picked it or mentioned it at least. But yes, do you guys have any honourable mentions before we finish?
My only one was the Blair Witch Project.
Oh, okay.
And it would have been in my top five, I guess, if I had my own single one. But because it's not really about the witch, it's about the kids, and then it's not really definitive as to
if
there was a witch. I mean, I've only seen it once about 10, 15 years ago, and I didn't think there was anything magical or mystical or witchy going on.
Okay.
The only point for me was that iconic shot at the end with the guy stood in the corner, and I thought, oh, that could be a little bit, he could be under a spell or something. But yeah, that's the only one I've got
as a honourable mention.
Yeah. I haven't seen it because I was terrified at just the trailer. So still haven't seen it to this day. I think I would still really struggle with it. Maybe I should try and watch it.
Yeah, I need to watch it.
Again. Yeah.
Behind.
I've never seen it either, but I know of some of the scenes and some of the iconography of it and the ending and stuff. So, but I think I will give it a go as well. I think I've heard the remake or reboot didn't go down as well. But they have it. When do those go down very, very well? Very rare. My honourable mentions will be Elvira, Mistress of the Dark from 1988. So the horror host did her own little film, and it's very fun and joyful and playful, and obviously she has fun with her large breasts and
obviously
and the feminist angle of that, and plays around with that and those tropes, and she becomes a witch because she finds a like great grandfather's cookbook or something. So but yeah, very tongue-in-cheek silly film. Mark of the Devil, which was said to be one of the most violent films ever made. They gave out sick bags, lots of torture scenes. German film, trying to recapture the Witchfinder general success. Very kind of hardcore. If you're looking for like watching men be evil and torturous and what it was probably really like during those Witch Hunter days, it's a hard watch, but I kind of enjoyed it as well because historically, because of just seeing the the kind of the people in power abuse that power, that religious rights, that, you know, religious moralism and all that sort of stuff. So that was interesting. The Wouldst from 2006 is kind of a little bit like 2000s version of The Craft a little bit.
Okay.
It's set in a private school in the 1960s, and girls are going missing, and they're not allowed to go into the Wouldst because there's something out there. And Bruce Campbell also shows up, and there's quite a few Evil Dead references, no doubt. I think there's even a few lines that are kind of Evil Dead references too that he says. So that's really fun. That's, again, a lot of kind of bitchy, you know, women, and like there's something definitely going on. It's very odd. A lot of interesting stuff. I think you'd like it, Lucy. There's a lot of kind of levels going on, things they're addressing in society and stuff. But yeah, I think that's on Amazon at the moment, so you can give that a watch.
Yeah.
The Worst Witch with Fairuza Balk and Tim Curry and Diana Rigg. Not the greatest film, I'll be honest. A lot of bad effects and, you know, cheesy stuff. But I'm going to use Tim Curry's Halloween song at the end of this podcast because I just find it so entertaining and it's wonderful. Yes, but our listener comments, they've got something to say. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to read those out now. So Math, he says, Hocus Pocus, The Craft, Witches of Eastwick, Stardust, and The Wizard of Oz. You like those choices?
I think the only one I've not seen is... I think Stardust is actually a great film.
Yeah, Stardust is great. Yeah.
Stardust is fab.
I think Michelle Pfeiffer's the witch in that.
Yeah.
That's really, really good film. Yeah. And this is like about stars, right? So she's like a sort of fallen star.
I think so. Something like that, yeah.
Mm.
That's great. Yeah. Hocus Pocus. I was kind of wanted that to kind of be on the list.
Okay.
I've never seen it. It's not as I have seen it a few times, and I think it's more kind of comedy, than say like The Craft.
I don't think it's as aged as well as The Craft in my opinion. There's a lot of virgin shaming in that, and and it's like, you're a virgin, you're still a virgin, and I'm like, he's 12, he should still be a virgin. He's 13, he should still be a virgin.
It must have come out around about the same time.
I think so.
I feel like there's just a lot of. I felt one thing I do remember is the stripy tights. I'm sure the stripy tights make an appearance.
Sarah Jessica Parker, and
yes, and that kind of like a bit sort of. And I feel like it kind of plays on that kind of a little bit of the Sleeping Beauty fairies.
Yes,
who are a little bit kind of
kooky
and maybe lapsed. Is it lapsidical? Is that the right word?
I don't think that's a word, but go ahead.
No? Is that the right word? Basically, a little bit kind of haphazard kind of.
Yeah. They're not quite right
and a bit sort of.
They're not perfectly evil, and they're not necessarily great at the witchcraft that they do.
Yeah, and that's kind of a bit sort of silly. But yeah, like also great film. And then what was the other one?
Witches of Eastwick. You seen that one?
I think I've not seen
that one.
I don't know if I've seen that.
Cher, Michelle Pfeiffer, I think again, and Susan Sarandon and Jack Nicholson.
I mean, that sounds really good. We need to watch that tomorrow.
It's good. I won't say any more, but I think it's Cher, Michelle Pfeiffer, Jack Nicholson, and Susan Sarandon. I think it's good. It almost made my list. I haven't rewatched it. I'd like to, but yes, Rhea, she says top five is hard. The Craft, The Love Witch, Practical Magic, Kiki's Delivery Service or Spirited Away, I can't decide, and The Vavitch. Honourable mentions to Stardust. And spoilers for the 1968 film, 1, 2, 3, Rosemary's Baby. Although I'm still wavering around whether it's a witch or a cult film. So
I think Rosemary's Baby, I mean, I don't really know.
I think you could go either way with it, I'll be honest. You could go either way.
A girl at my old work, she's called Rose, and we had a film night, and it was about favourite horror films, I think, and she, Rosemary's Baby was one of hers. We watched a little bit of it. I haven't seen the whole film, but I did get her some Rosemary's Baby socks. for Secret Santa. She loved them.
I didn't know those were available. Mm.
They are available.
Okay.
Yep, they are available. And
next time someone
them.
Has a baby, that's what they're getting
Rosemary's
from me.
Baby socks, yeah.
What are you trying to say? It's the spawn of Satan. What are you trying to say? Yes. So I am Jack's musings. He says the Blair Witch Project, The Love Witch. The Love Witch, I do recommend.
What's The Love Witch? I don't think I've heard of that one.
It's like it's a 2000, I think I want to say 2010 film within that kind of era. And it's shot like it's a 60s, 70s movie, like Suspiria.
Okay.
And it's all about this woman who is trying to find love, but all she ever does is hook up with terrible men and then, you know, curses them, basically. So there's something in there. But the way it's shot, the way it looks, you would think it was a 60s or a 70s movie.
Wow.
It looks that good, like that.
Amazing.
But it was made in the, you know, 2010s. The Love Witch, Drag Me to Hell, Suspiria, and Mary Poppins and Her Return.
Mary Poppins.
Could
That's
she be
interesting.
Could she be considered a witch? She's got an umbrella flying around on that.
Yeah. She's just kind of magic.
She jumps
stuff.
Into paintings.
Yes, she does. She has a big bag.
Yeah. Big bag. She's got a big bag.
She's got a big bag. What was it? Mary Poppins Returns?
Mary Poppins Returns, the one with Emily Blunt in. They did a very late sequel.
Interesting. That's an interesting one. I might kind of watch that again, actually. I think I saw a little bit of that. Is there a scene in a bath where there's a load of dolphins, or is that Shank?
Of all the people I know, Lucy, I think you're the only person I know who would mix up Mary Poppins Returns with Showgirls. But
I think there's a dolphin scene
maybe,
in a bath.
Maybe.
And that sticks out for me.
Maybe. There's definitely, I mean, they're both in bodies of water and they both are kind of dolphin-esque. So I'll give you that.
I really hope that's right and I've not mixed that up.
I haven't seen it, so I can't say. But I really hope there's more similarities between the two films. I really do. Blake Biles says, Spirited Away, Kiki's Delivery Service, Howl's Moving Castle, The Wizard of Oz, and Ewoks, The Battle for Endor. Don't remind me of that, Blake, ever again.
I've seen Spirited Away.
Yeah. Lovely. These are all kind of, most of those are kind of like Studio Ghibli, those.
Mm. What's the second from last one?
Wizard of Oz?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, oh, of course.
A lot of witches in that.
Striking socks in that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She's kind of...
Got a good witch, bad witch.
Yeah.
Well, two bad witches. One of them gets a house on her straight away.
Scott's dad's in Wizard of Oz coming up.
Oh, yeah? Was it a pantomime?
Yeah.
Very nice.
He's Oz.
He said he's going to listen to this podcast as well.
Oh, really? Well.
Hello, Dad.
Cut out the swearing.
He doesn't like any of the swearing.
If he
doesn't like any of the swearing. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Good luck with that. I'm sure you'll make a wonderful Oz. I think that would be great.
Mm. Yeah, he's the wizard at the end.
Yeah? Oh,
and the
perfect.
Man behind the curtain.
Yeah. There he is. I'm the man behind the podcast. He's the man behind the curtain. So, yes, good luck with that. I'm sure you'll be fantastic. So, Tony Farina says, The Craft Legacy. He says, Craft Legacy, Electric Boogaloo, Stardust, Wizard of Oz, and Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Oh, Bedknobs and Broomsticks. Mm. I never got on with that.
Oh, I like it. I like it.
Weird.
Yeah. It's a kind of a spiritual sequel to Mary Poppins. I think it's a little underrated. There's not many Disney films where a witch with the powers of Satan fights Nazis. Like, it's like the Railway Children meets the Witch. It's like, that's like, you don't get that. You don't get that in a Disney film.
No. Yeah.
When a Nazi's ever in Disney films. And it's on Disney Plus. It's there. I think it's the longer version, so I think it's like 2+ hours of stuff. But I like it.
A lot of love for Stardust.
Yeah, surprising amount of love for Stardust.
Yeah. I didn't even think about that one.
Yeah, I did consider it, but I didn't rewatch it because there's quite a lot going on in that film. So I was like, I don't know if
Ricky
it's
Gervais.
A
Ricky Gervais.
Robert De Niro is a gay pirate.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Charlie Cox is the love interest, Daredevil.
Oh yeah,
that's him. A lot going on, yeah. Right, so that's it. That's our Witches podcast. Again, we're trying. Hopefully, the audio comes out okay on this one. But I think we've done our best. We've been cursed by bad technology, so I'll have to look at that when I come back off my holiday. Thank you very much, guys. Where can people find you on social media if they want to find you, or if you want them to find you?
In the woods, probably.
In the woods, the deep dark woods.
In the woods.
With Red Riding Hood.
Scott Hodgey, H-O-D-G-E-Y, on Twitter and Instagram.
I think it's Mr. Molly.
Mr. Molly? Mr. Molly. So your Mr. Molly's your cat, so that's your Instagram handle?
Yes. Yeah, Mr. Molly the cat.
Mr. Molly the cat, right? Well, they'll all be in the show notes, the links, so you can click on it. So even if you've got them wrong, I'll get them right. Don't worry, I've got him. I've got
him. Thank you, Dan. Thank you. Excellent. For having us.
Thank you very much for having me around. You've had a wonderful spread. We've had a wonderful time. I've really enjoyed it, so I appreciate you giving me your time. I know you've just come off holiday and everything, so I do really appreciate you sitting down and putting up with all this again, much like when I locked myself out of my house.
No, but
the witches did. It wasn't me. It was the witches. I was cursed. If you want to find me, join the Prattalion and be briefed in full on the Secret Balls, swing over to Prattle World at www.spiderdanandthesecretballs.com. And don't forget to use the hashtag #PrepareForPrattle when you interact with us. Please subscribe to the Pop Culture Collective newsletter to find out what myself, Comics in Motion, and all the other related podcasts are up to week by week. I'd like to thank my patrons on Patreon. I am Jack's Musing, Simon Cotton, Paul Meller, Max Byrne, Mike Burton, Angry Andy, Tonya Todd, Tony Farina, Math, Scott Hodgson,
hey.
And Rhea Carrigan as well. Thank you for your continuing donations. It is very much appreciated. It helps Prattle World keep on turning. And if you ever find yourself in a position to help the podcast, please consider it. I hope you've enjoyed the last and final Shock-Phobai Fest episode of 2023. It's been a blast. It's been a good year. Some good podcast content coming your way. I hope you've loved every minute of it, and I hope you've had a wonderful spooky season.
It's great to be here with you young witches on this fabulous night. Remember, girls, show the world. Let them know it's Halloween.
I wouldn't change places with anyone tonight. We'll carve pumpkin faces and watch the witches' flight. Every human heart will shudder. Every soul will shake with fear. Tonight, the creepiest. Tonight, the scariest. Tonight, the most wonderful night. Anything can happen on Halloween. Your dog could turn into a cat. There may be a toad in your bass guitar, or your sister could turn into a bat. Christmas time brings the snow. Summertime brings the sun. But on Halloween, your blood begins to run.
Something spooky is going down.
Anything can happen on Halloween. It's better than a video. Gremlins gonna mess up every cassette from London to Idaho. April 1st can be fun. New Year's Eve is a bore. But on Halloween, your flesh begins to crawl.
Oh, I'm losing control.
Anything can happen on Halloween. Your toenails grow long and your hair turns green. Could become a sardine. Your dentist could turn into a queen.
Has anybody seen my tambourine? I may start playing big in the beginning. The craziest night you've ever seen. This hair.